Okay, guys, so you read that correctly. That is not clickbait. Pimax has been chosen by Microsoft as their official peripheral partner for Microsoft Flight Sim 2024. Now, how did this happen? And it's kind of simple. After the world preview event in Arizona, which I got to attend and try out Microsoft Flight Sim 2024 with VR using the Pimax Crystal Light, and their overall response from the community, they said, you know what, let's work with Pimax. So now this video, we're gonna talk about three things. Number one, how the Pimax Crystal compares to the Pimax Crystal Light, which we have here. So we'll talk about this headset. Number two is the experience of VR, the immersion, how I feel, you know, how cool it is. I'm gonna try to put into words for you guys. And finally, let's say you don't want to rock with Pimax and there's another headset on the market which you like, and that's great. I mean, there's so many options out there. Why this benefits you, really? This is a really big deal, and we're going to talk about those things. So let's get into it. Thank you for watching, and rock and roll. Here we go. If it's your first time here, welcome to the channel. My name's Jose. I'm an air traffic controller here at Tampa International Airport. I'm a huge VR flight sim nerd, and on this channel, we talk about everything flight sim VR related. So welcome, subscribe, let's hang out, and let's talk a little bit more. Now, guys, I did get to first try the Pimax Crystal Light out in Flight Sim Expo in Vegas. It was super awesome. Got to try it in DCS there, and I was just blown away initially by the clarity compared to the Reverb G2. I also got to use it in Arizona, guys. Arizona at the Microsoft Flight Sim World Preview event, which was super awesome, which Microsoft invited me to go out and test out Microsoft Flight Sim 2024. And this is really how this headset got chosen. So after having such great feedback from the community and from the people that got to use it, and I'm sure they have people testing it within their own departments, you know, they said, you know what, this is going to be probably a great partner. So I don't know if Microsoft reached out to them or if they reached out to Microsoft, but this was great news. And this is really great news for all of us in the industry, just because of the fact that VR is growing. We're getting, you know, larger on the radar. We're not just a small blip. And even though Phil Spencer's not a fan of VR just yet, you Xbox users do have to come on over. So still working on that. And I'll send Phil Spencer an email, somebody tweet him and tag me so I can talk to him. And I really just want to know what his idea is behind VR. But moving forward, guys, look, there's multiple headsets on the market. We have things, let's say the Quest 3, the Somnium VR1, Valve Deckard, multiple headsets, and they all range in different qualities and perspectives, which might be important to you depending on what you're looking for, right? But here, Pimax has been chosen by Microsoft after the good performance that they had, and I think that's really cool. And let's talk really about the Pimax Crystal and the Crystal Light real fast. So the Pimax Crystal came first, and it was a wireless headset that had a battery, had auto IPD adjustment, had, I believe, a Snapdragon processor inside of it, dynamic foveated rendering, which was done by the tracking of the eyes. So once they got rid of those three or four features, it ended up bringing down the price and bringing down the weight of the headset, making it comparable to what I have right now, which is like the Quest 3 with a battery pack and everything else. So it's not the lightest headset on the market, but it's also not the heaviest headset on the market. Now, guys, some of the key features have remained, being the high resolution display is a 2880 by 2880 resolution, which is 17 million pixels. The field of view also has not changed. Now, it was advertised at 115 degrees horizontal with 105 vertical. And in my experience, I got much closer to like 102, both vertical and horizontal. Now, when you look at that overall in VR, it's a really good experience. It doesn't quite feel like a tunnel or like binocular visions. It does feel pretty good. But one thing we're going to be able to get with this headset is going to be the local dimming, and also has a spheric lenses, which is not quite the same as pancake lenses, but it's not your Fresnel lenses. So it's a very crystal clear image. A spheric lens is what you have on your cameras. The glass is round, it's smooth, there's no edges. So it just increases your visual clarity so much more. In fact, you know, I really have a hard time seeing any pixels. There's like no pixels on this. So let's talk about three benefits of the Crystal Light. And I just kind of went over one, but the reduced weight. So the reduced weight is going to be excellent, because it's going to mean increased playtime for you guys. And actually, let's talk real fast about the comfort and fit, because I don't want to forget about that. Here is my awesome mannequin. I'm going to move this out of the way. For this headset and other headsets that have this strap, guys, you want the weight on the top of your forehead and on the lower back. That's achieved by extending this strap, guys. Really extend this strap, give it a little bit more room, drop this lower on your back, and what you end up is with reduced weight on your cheek. If you have the back of the head strap higher, this is going to fall lower, putting pressure on your cheeks, and that definitely does not feel great. So pro tip, hopefully that came out correctly there. I can't see my face. You want the back lower, and that you want the weight on the top of your forehead and on the back of your head. That's definitely going to make it feel more comfortable. So the second benefit of the Pimax Crystal Light is the lowered cost. By removing some of those hardware features, guys, the price came down. And so you can actually get the Pimax Crystal light without controllers for $800, which you don't need the controllers to set it up. I believe the base kind of gets a little wonky. The base of the Pimax Crystal light on the software is wherever you have the headsets. If on your, if it's on your table, the base of the floor is there. Not that it matters. Once you go into VR and you hit the space bar or whatever to auto center, it gets fixed. So you don't even need the controllers to fly in VR. But if you want to click around and do things and play other games, I recommend get it, because honestly, once you have the experience of shooting zombies in VR and taking a break from flying, you're going to kind of want to try that again. It's a lot of fun. It really is. So let's talk real fast about the Pimax Play software, guys, and the native integration of OpenXR. So that has helped out so much. One of the things that I was worried about when I got the headset was like, how complicated is this? I had kind of heard some people having issues on the software, but they've been putting in the time, putting in the work on it, and it was literally plug and play. Now, I know my buddy Evan did not have that experience, but also he had the headset before I had that native OpenXR, and he's running multiple programs. Honestly, my recommendation is, you know, just run the Pimax Play software and that's it. Don't add anything else. Try not to tweak anything else. And whatever settings you start adjusting, maybe adjust them either in the Pimax Play software, because there's quite a few, or also Microsoft Flight Sim by lowering the graphics, which surprisingly enough, do not make the game look terrible. They just kind of give you a little bit more headroom to enjoy the sim. But Pimax Play software has been improving, and the fact that you have 72, 90, and 120 hertz available, depending on what sim you're running, it's super awesome. And you don't have that whole battery to deal with and your display port, so you have low latency. Overall, they did a really good job, and that's why some people said the Pimax Crystal Lite was what the Pimax Crystal should have been, just because the majority, now the people saying that, it's the majority of the community who love to be just directly plugged into the computer, whether you're racing, flying, and you don't want to have any of those issues of being wireless. So overall, the Pimax Play software has been really good. So I really do think that Pimax is committed to improving their software, their hardware, and their engagement with the community. My discussions with them, you know, I've emphasized quality control, you know, how important that is, you know, trying to understand what is it that they're doing to ensure that these products are making it in your hands and not needing to be returned. So the Pimax Crystal Lite has lenses that cannot be removed. So if let's say that headset was on or there was an issue with the lens or the display, and this wasn't caught before the unit was shipped out, which honestly, you know, the videos show a very thorough process here, but something's happening that a few of you guys have had some units received. And like I said, look, I've told them this is the biggest thing, you know, with turnaround times, users, we're investing this money. We want this product to work. I'm letting them know, look, this is important. This is important for the community to have products that work. And not to be just taken out by little things, you know, and it's a waste for them. It's a waste of time. It's a waste of money. But that's not the majority. Let me just be clear. But I do want to address it just because no product is perfect. So how has VR improved my flight sim experience, guys? And really, the unparalleled immersion you get from flight simulation is absolutely amazing. You know, having that sense of depth and scale and that perception of distance is really unique. You know, you really feel like you're inside the aircraft. You can look around in any direction. And what's happening is that the devs are starting to really get these aircraft detailed in a way that looks very personal. The aircraft looked very lived in and very worn. And as you look around, there's scratches or different stuff on the aircraft, which makes it look realistic. They're not just doing a perfect polished aircraft that has no wear and tear. Users are saying, hey, listen, this looks pristine. We want to fly a plane that looks worn, that has scratches. And you see that in the aircraft as you're flying in it. You see fingerprints on the windows and scratches on the glass. And that, to me, having that level of immersion, feeling like you're inside the aircraft is the best way I can tell you, is huge. Now, another thing you get is that situational awareness of just knowing where you're at. You have the natural head movements. Let's say you're flying in the pattern and you're at your home airport. And, you know, I love doing this. I love just hitting the pattern, whether it's an F-16 or a Skyhawk. Naturally, looking to your left and there's the airport. Perfect. There's a blue building. All right, now it's time to turn my base. And having that ability to do that in VR is so cool because it feels so natural. It's not like, you know, you're using a triple screen monitor where you look and there's no depth. Like, you look to your left and you're like, all right, I'm 2,000 feet up, or okay, I'm 100 feet off the ground. You know, I need to add some power and get out of here. So the natural head movements of looking around the cockpit, and if you haven't tried dogfighting, you will break your neck. You know, you will have mad respect for fighter pilots just because it's a lot of work trying to find an enemy who's on your six in VR is neck-breaking. It's exhausting, and I'm not ready for that, but it's really, really cool. So another aspect here is a realistic cockpit interaction. So now the VR controllers do work okay. You know, it's something that I wish they were done better. In X-Plane, they are flawless. I'm talking about when you turn the dial to the right, it's just spot on. I have seen a couple users do pretty well with them, but for me, my luck has been, it's okay. Sometimes I go flip the trigger or flip the switch and it goes the wrong way. I'm just not a fan of how it's not quite as accurate as I want it to be. It's okay. Again, it just, that could infinitely be improved, but having the interactive controls, whether you're using your mouse or controller, it just really does increase immersion, going through the checklist, flipping the switches, and eventually, hopefully, we'll get hand tracking. But I don't know how far we are from that, but that would be amazing, having hand tracking support where you can just flip switches and do them and coordinate and do everything else in your aircraft. That, to me, is going to be really, really cool. So I probably should have mentioned this earlier, but, you know, how does VR increase your immersion and specifically depth perception? So what you get, stereoscopic 3D or 3D VR, really, it enhances your experience by mimicking the way that humans see the world. We have a left and right eye, meaning it shoots or it records a left image and a right image. And when you put them together, you're able to tell depth apart just because that it literally recreates what we see in real life. And VR does that so well that you have a proper sense of depth. And these depth clues really help out with your landing, with your formation flights, with your maneuvering, actually even with helicopters. As you're flying with the helicopter, I was talking with my buddy Evan, and you look past your feet, you see the target where you're going to go land at, you see exactly what you're looking at, looking off to your right-hand side. Flying in helicopters in VR adds a whole level of depth. And if you guys fly helicopters, let me know, is that not like the coolest thing ever to be able to do in VR? Because to me, I think it really is. It's just so much fun controlling the aircraft. It's not easy. It's not easy. Which, by the way, check out Sergio at helisimmer.com, my buddy over there. He does great work for the helisimmer community. And, you know, you'll learn through him, through some of his articles and stuff, that there's a lot of little techniques and different things you can do in Microsoft Flight Sim to help you learn how to fly helicopters. But helicopters in VR is really increased your immersion and depth perception by having that VR aspect to it, as opposed to flying in 2D. It's just 9-day difference. You cannot tell how high you are in 2D. In VR, you can tell. So one thing to know, guys, prescription lenses. I still have 20/20 vision for now, and I don't need them. But our buddy Mark over at Sim Hangar Flight, who has an excellent video on this, is where I would recommend for you to go check out and see what he has to say when it comes to Microsoft Flight Sim 2020. I'm sorry, not Microsoft Flight Sim 2020, but the Pimax Crystal Light and getting VR headsets. There's a couple really key features. I did watch the video, and it was a good video. I just redirect anybody there that asks about it just because it's a great video. It's well done. He explains that he did a lot of research. And again, these headsets do work with prescription lenses. But go and talk to, go watch his video over there. I'll leave it linked below. And so one of the biggest things that you get from flying in VR is really the motivation to go and explore. It's something that in 2D, I mean, you might do that leg over and over. You might have your long haul flight, but something about flying in VR, you're like, you know what? I want to go see what the mountains in Kauai are like, or I want to go down to Papua New Guinea, or I want to go to the Bahamas or check out Bora Bora. There's something about being and checking out these locations in VR. I remember actually seeing a video on TV and it was showing Hong Kong. And I remember I'm like, I knew it was the Hong Kong skyline because I have seen that skyline before in VR and it was accurate. So it's really neat. You start exploring different areas in the world where for some reason in 2D, I don't know, I just kind of, it's not bad, but I feel that much more drawn to go check it out in VR because I feel like I've been there. It's crazy. You just have that amazing depth perception, that immersion that you do not get on 2D. All right, so I said this earlier, and honestly, whether or not you choose a Pimax Crystal Light headset or you choose a different headset, it is critical the fact that Microsoft has highlighted them as their flagship headset or company they're going to be working with, because it really shows that even though we're a niche within a niche, is the fact that Microsoft has acknowledged that VR is growing and that we're a contender to be at the table, and there's a whole market behind this. This is really why having improved software and hardware support is going to come as a result of this, is the fact that we're going to have enhanced integration, right? Pimax is going to start taking it more seriously, which I mean, I think they have already, but Microsoft is going to be like, hey, look, Pimax is working hard on this. what can we hopefully do better to make this a little bit easier for them, whether it's adding dynamic 48 rendering, quad views displays. Now let's talk about what I think Microsoft can do to improve VR, because I just kind of want to throw this out here. We had a lot of people that were asking about this on my first flight of the F-18 in the Arizona footage. On Microsoft Flight Sim 2024. And one of the biggest things I would definitely ask for is dynamic foveated rendering for those headsets that support that. Fixed foveated rendering being native would be excellent. Having Pimax quad view display supported natively, that's going to be key. I mean, it really is. Hopefully this stuff gets knocked out. I know Pimax has already mentioned this. I've already asked on it. So I'm kind of just like doubling down on it here. And improved hand tracking and controller tracking. I think that's a really big deal for some of us who are, you know, using VR. But for me, one of the biggest things is having single view display output, left or right eye, HD, so we can kind of show off, not only create content, but, you know, have family and friends see over our shoulder and not have to show that split screen view, which nobody likes to watch. So those are some of the things that I would love to see Microsoft improve over time. So to me, that really means that Microsoft's commitment to VR is going to attract more investments from companies and people really trying to get into VR and innovate more hardware. Like we got Wing Wing, Moza, all these companies, Verbal, putting out great hardware for flight simulation. Guys, it's never been a better time to be a simmer. Now, for my Xbox folks out there, I'm still trying to talk to Phil Spencer. Like I said, Phil's not on board yet with the VR program, and Xbox, you know, you guys are still having to come over to PC, but that's okay. PC is the master race. We know that already, guys. Now, if you're curious if your computer is ready for Microsoft Flight Sim 2024 in VR and to handle the Pimax Crystal Light, check out this video here where I talk about the Microsoft Flight Sim requirements and whether or not you should upgrade your computer now here as we lead into the launch in about 3 weeks. So check out the video. Let me know what you think, and take it easy, guys. Thanks for watching. Peace out.